Welcome everybody, it's the fourth of our four-part series on dealing with challenges to the faith, and the focus has been in many respects on intellectual challenges. People that say they don't believe it because it's mythological or for whatever reason, it's just a matter of faith. And so tonight is going to consider one aspect of that, and I think it's going to be a really fun night. I hope you can relax, let your fingers warm up, and lean back in your seats and just enjoy a very pleasant evening together as we consider one part of it. I'm going to do a little introduction and then pass things over to George. I'll share when I was a pastor in Minnesota, one of the items that kept coming up in the rural paper in the area where I lived from time to time would be people who claimed that they had seen a Black Panther. So a Black Panther would be a type of the mountain lion that happened to be all black. And people claimed in South Minnesota there that they had seen them. And the experts said, no, you couldn't have seen one because there are no Black Panthers in Minnesota. But people would say, well, I don't care what you say, I saw one. And the experts would say, no, you saw a black lab, or you saw a cat and it was looked bigger than it was in the shadows. And some people said, no, I saw one. And it reveals something that I think is really interesting and valuable. That when you have an experience of something, when you personally experienced it, no one can talk you out of it, right? And so when we're describing how we want to learn to be able to share our faith with people who question it or have doubts about it, I'm so glad, especially like Peter's been reading this book on apologetics, I'm so glad people are learning. You're learning about the Bible prophecies. You're learning about creationism, you're learning about the arguments for the resurrection and for the existence of God. And those are all good things. But every one of you sitting here is right now fully qualified to share with somebody else. Because at the very least, if someone says, well, why do you go to that church? Why do you believe all that Christian nonsense? Every one of you is able to say, because I know it's made a big change in my life. I believe that Jesus is real and that I've experienced him. Now, as pastors, we steer away from that mostly, right? Because some people do have a crisis of faith, and so we're always trying to get people to put their faith in the objective Word of God, not in how they feel. But, so we don't throw the baby out with the bathwater. Let's affirm right here that there's plenty of Scripture that says you have an experience with the Holy Spirit touching your life. You have an experience with God. You're like the blind man in John chapter 8 when the Pharisees confronted him and said, you don't know anything. He said, well, this I know. Once I was blind, but now I can see. So much scripture that says now you know because of that. So don't shy away from that. You can always be ready to share that Christ has changed your life. And you, whatever arguments there are mentally and intellectually, you know in your heart that this is real because you've experienced it. That's a good thing. And that also then becomes the impetus for so much of our wonderful Christian hymnody. When you think about all the songs that have been written that spring forth from the person's real and personal experience of God's work in their life and the marvelous things that they've seen felt and come to know. That's part of what makes it so beautiful. So George has a lot of resources here, and he's picked out some marvelous songs and hymns where we're going to be able to consider just very briefly the background to that song, the experience from which somebody let that flow out of their heart, and then we'll sing each one together. And I hope and pray that it'll be a joyful time.
Sure. Thank you, Pastor. The book Pastor is going to use is one that I have. There were a couple people already said, I have that book at home. It's a wonderful book based on the hymn, so we have these all marked. Pastor's going to read one rather than me reading and playing, and so I can get ready for the next selection as well. But they're all marked in here, and he can go ahead, and he's going to read these to you. I have two other books, and just real quickly, one is called The One-Year Book of Hymns. That's another great resource there. And also Meditations on 366 Best Loved Hymns Near to the Heart of God. We're only going to take about 300 tonight. So I'm very, very pleased to do this. We were going to do something like this in April, on Wednesday nights, and then COVID hit. So we didn't have those classes there. But anyway, in the Lutheran Witness for February that just came, Singing the Word, it's a great, great article in there. You should take a look at that. I'm just going to reference to just a few areas in here. The pastor spoke about scripture being in music, and what a wonderful gift. I could speak on this all day and night and have many, many Wednesdays, and we would still just touch the highlights of hymns. Many beautiful, all beautiful hymns, I should say. The Holy Spirit teaches us the purpose of singing hymns in Colossians 3:16. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teaching and admonishing one another in all wisdom, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs with thankfulness in your hearts to God. Therefore, I'm skipping around, therefore sing. You are not singing for fame or the approval of men. You sing to rejoice in the Lord. You sing to help you and your children be faithful. And there's a great section in this article, too, about singing at home. If you're alone, that's fine. Husband and wife or children, use those for daily devotions, and you perhaps do that. The world is filled with bad music, much of it devised to meet a specific taste or express some worldly concern or desire. But the hymns of the church are not so. They are not geared toward any individual taste. They are written for the purpose of teaching the word of Christ so that we might obtain and preserve our faith and the faith of those whom we love. Let us hide God's word in our hearts through psalms and hymns and spiritual songs so that we might teach each other the truth we need to hear at all times. If you would like to see this, I think there's a copy in the back also. Do sing at home. It's a great way to, the pastor mentioned in his sermon about going into private and praying. You could do that with singing hymns about how you feel. Are you depressed? Are you praising God? On the other hand, witness to yourself and listen to the words. I want to thank Nadine for taking all my scribble sheets, you know, and putting this all together here and selecting a few of the hymns as well. So, okay, Pastor, please.
All right, our first one is Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee. Henry Van Dyke was serving as a guest preacher at Williams College in the Berkshire Mountains of Massachusetts when he was so moved by the beauty of God's creation that he wrote this hymn of joy. The next morning, he handed the poem to the college president. Here's a hymn for you, he said. Your mountains were my inspiration. It must be sung to the music of Beethoven's Hymn to Joy, and it has been ever since. Van Dyke was not only a Presbyterian minister, but he was also the author of many books, including the best-selling The Other Wise Man. He was a professor of literature at Princeton University, Navy chaplain during World War I, an ambassador to Holland and Luxembourg under President Woodrow Wilson. When Van Dyke published this hymn in 1911, he noted that it was to be sung by people who are not afraid that any truth of science will destroy their religion, or that any revolution on earth will overthrow the kingdom of heaven. With such confidence, Christians had much to rejoice about.
Thank you. Our next selection is "It Is Well With My Soul." The year had been filled with tragedy when Horatio Spafford, a 43-year-old Chicago businessman, penned this hymn. He and his wife were still grieving over the death of their son when the great Chicago fire struck and caused them financial disaster. He realized that his family needed to get away, so that fall he decided to take his wife and four daughters to England. His wife and daughters went ahead on the SS Ville du Havre. He planned to follow in a few days, but on the Atlantic, the Ville du Havre was struck by another ship and sank within 12 minutes. More than 200 lives were lost, including Spafford's four daughters. When survivors were brought to shore at Cardiff, Wales, Mrs. Spafford cabled her husband with the words, "Saved alone." He booked passage on the next ship. It was while crossing the Atlantic that Spafford penned the words to the hymn, "When sorrows like sea billows roll, it is well with my soul." Is "I Stand Amazed." In the early 1900s, Charles H. Gabriel was the king of gospel music. Gabriel wrote the words and music for a number of hymns used by popular evangelists of his day, such as Billy Sunday and his song leader, Homer Roadheater. Gabriel's hymns reflect a change in the style of gospel music. In the 1800s, hymns were deeply theological and often meditative. But with the revivals of Moody and Sunday, Christians learned to love songs that were fun to sing, highly energetic, and easy to remember. Perhaps Gabriel's most popular hymn is, "Oh, That Will Be Glory for Me," with its rousing chorus. He also wrote "Send the Light," a stirring missionary call with a tune that drives the singer halfway across the ocean. These songs, like "I Stand Amazed in the Presence," focus on a simple emotion and celebrate it. In this case, it is raw amazement at the magnitude of Christ's sacrifice. We love this song because we can identify with it. How can we help but stand amazed in His presence? How marvelous, how wonderful.
Thank you.
my faith has found a resting place. The pioneering radio preacher Donald Gray Barnhouse used to ask, when you get to the pearly gates and God asks, what right do you have to come into my heaven, what will you say? This song is an answer to that question. Some might flash their church membership cards or dangle their perfect attendance Sunday school pins before the master. Some might spout the theology they've learned or present their resumes packed with good deeds. You should let me in because I would be an asset to your community. I would sing alto in your choir, and I could help out with the youth group. But God does not run heaven like a country club or a successful corporation. We cannot get in on our own qualifications. The door is barred to all who try to earn their entry, but it swings wide open for the simple saint who affirms in faith, I need no other argument, I need no other plea. It is enough that Jesus died, and that he died for me. Fifth selection is I Will Sing of My Redeemer. It's not easy to keep the Christian faith bottled up. Throughout history, various rulers have tried to keep Christians from preaching the gospel, but with little success. Ancient Rome would not have minded if Christians had just kept to themselves, privately enjoying their faith. But Christianity doesn't work that way. As the apostles told the authorities in Jerusalem, we cannot stop telling about everything we have seen and heard. Philip Paul Bliss, the author of this gospel song, was the song leader for evangelist Major Daniel W. Whittle. Whittle, who had been taken prisoner during the Civil War, was converted while in prison by reading the New Testament. A few years after he got out of the army, he became an evangelist, and he asked Philip Bliss to be his song leader. 3 years later, however, Bliss and his wife died in a train accident. This hymn text was found in Bliss's trunk. James McGranahan, who succeeded Bliss as Whittle's song leader, wrote the music.
Thank you.
selection, I'd rather have Jesus. When the mother of George Beverly Shea put a poem on their family piano, she had no idea what would happen. Most likely, she wanted her son to read the words and make some changes in his life's direction. It looked as if he were heading for a career singing popular music on NBC. He had impressed everyone who heard him, and he admits that he was lured by the possibilities. But then he saw the poem on the piano, and he was moved by the words. He sat down at the piano and started singing a tune that seemed to fit the words. Shea didn't know it at the time, but his mother was listening in the next room, and she asked him to sing it in church the next day. So the words by Rhea Miller and the tune by George Beverly Shea were cemented together. Bev Shea's life direction changed because of that hymn. A few years later, he became associated with evangelist Billy Graham and sang the hymn around the world. Seventh selection, the church's one foundation. Windsor on the Thames with its royal castle is one of England's most popular tourist attractions. Samuel Stone's ministry was located here among the poorer people at the outskirts of town. Samuel Stone was a fighter. He stood up for what he believed, and if local toughs threatened the neighborhood, he was not afraid to take them on. In the Church of England, Stone was regarded as a fundamentalist, opposing the liberal theological tendencies of his day. When he was 27, he wrote a collection of hymns based on the Apostles' Creed. This hymn, taken from that collection, is based on the article in the Creed regarding the church as the body of Christ. 2 years later, Anglicans from around the world met to discuss the crucial theological issues that were raging in the church. Significantly, they chose Stone's hymn as the processional for their historic conference.
I have to tell you about the church's one foundation a little bit. That one is one of the most nearest and dearest to my heart. Don Herman, who some of you met here, long retired from St. Peter at this time in Arlington Heights, wrote a special arrangement with the brass group and with some string instruments, an adult choir they had at that time, and children's choir. And that large church there, he wrote this for my retirement service. And what a beautiful, beautiful arrangement that he wrote in the church's one foundation. I think that should be our number one. What is a church? Our foundation in our life.
faith is amazing grace. The tombstone of John Newton, the author of this hymn, tells his story. John Newton, clerk, once an infidel and libertine, a servant of slavers in Africa, was by the rich mercy of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, preserved, restored, pardoned, and appointed to preach the faith he had so long labored to destroy. Those words were written by John Newton himself, and they are a testimony to God's transforming power. After years as a hardened slave trader, Newton met Jesus Christ, and his life was dramatically turned around. Throughout his years of ministry, God's amazing grace remained central to his thinking. When it was suggested he retire at the age of 82 due to poor health and failing memory, he responded, "My memory is nearly gone, but I remember two things, that I am a great sinner and that Christ is a great Savior." Wrote more than 8,000 hymns and used more than 200 pen names. Under contract to a music publisher, she wrote 3 new hymns each week during much of her adult life. The fact that she was blind didn't diminish her productivity. She would formulate an entire song in her mind and then dictate it to a friend or a secretary. One of her good friends was Phoebe Palmer Knapp, wife of the founder of Metropolitan Life Insurance Company. One time when Nat came to Brooklyn to see Crosby, she brought a tune with her that she had composed. "Play it for me on the organ," Crosby requested. Nat did, and then asked, "What does this tune say?" She turned to see Crosby kneeling in prayer. Nat played it a second time, and then a third. Finally, the blind woman responded, "That says, 'Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine.'"
Thank you.
10th selection is Great is Thy Faithfulness. Thomas Chisholm certainly had his share of disappointments in life. Born in a crude log cabin in Kentucky, he never had a chance to attend high school or college. His health was fragile, forcing him to resign as a Methodist minister after only 1 year. He began writing, but received more than his share of rejection letters. Even when his poems were published, he seldom received any money for them. At the age of 57, he wrote the hymn, Great is Thy Faithfulness, based on the verses in Lamentations that say, His compassions fail not, they are new every morning. Great is Thy Faithfulness, chapter 3, verses 22 and 23. Later, when he was asked how he came to write the hymn, he said there were no special circumstances surrounding it, but he simply wrote about God's faithfulness from studying the Bible. Number 11, How Great Thou Art. In 1885, Carl Boberg, a 26-year-old preacher, wrote a poem titled in Swedish, O Stora Gud, translated into English, it's O Great God. Boberg had no thought of his poems becoming a hymn, so a few years later he was surprised to hear his poem sung to the tune of an old Swedish melody. A generation later, in the early 1920s, English missionary Stuart Hine and his wife were ministering in Poland, where they learned the Russian version of Boberg's poem sung to the Swedish melody. Later, Hine created English words for it and arranged the Swedish melody to fit. This is the hymn we know now as How Great Thou Art. The first three stanzas were inspired by an experience Stuart Hine had as he ministered in the Carpathian Mountains and heard the mighty thunder echoing all around him. As he pushed on, he was deeply impressed by the beauty of the woods and forest glades, as well as the singing of the birds. The fourth stanza came after he returned to England. The song became popular in America in the 1950s, and before long, it was the number one hymn on both sides of the Atlantic. Thank you. 12th selection is In Times Like These. Late in 1943, Ruth K. Jones, mother of five and wife of a busy pastor, was reading 2 Timothy 3, verse 1, which says, "In the last days, perilous times shall come." As she read the Pittsburgh paper, saw the war, World War II casualty lists, and watched the slow progress of Allied troops moving up the boot of Italy, it seemed that perilous times had already come. Rationing was hitting hard. Discouragement was everywhere. How long could people continue in times like these? Ruth took out a small notepad from her apron pocket and started writing some words. A melody came to her as she wrote. She had no formal music training, and she wasn't trying to do something to make it herself famous, but it was the right song for the right time. Soon people around the world were singing it. Years later, when she watched a Billy Graham telecast and heard George Beverly Shea sing it, tears came to her eyes, and she said, "I can't believe I had any part in writing this song. I just feel that God gave it to me, and I gave it to the world." Last selection of the night, we give glory and thanks to God who worked in the hearts of his people to inspire the beauty of music that still encourages us even to this day. We thank you, Lord, for George and the gift you've given to him that he shares with all of us. Amen. Our closing song then, as we finish, is "Crown Him with Many Crowns." Matthew Bridges became a convert to Roman Catholicism at the age of 48 and published this hymn 3 years later under the title, "The Song of the Seraphs." Godfrey Thuring, an Anglican clergyman, added several stanzas to the hymn about 30 years later with Bridges' approval. So a Roman Catholic layman and an Anglican cleric, who probably never met, were co-authors of a hymn about heaven, where Christians of every tribe and tongue and denomination will crown him Lord of all. One aspect that Godfrey Thuring felt was missing in the original hymn was a stanza on the resurrection, and so he added, "His glories now we sing, who died and rose on high, who died eternal life to bring, and lives that death may die." At a large gathering at the Royal Albert Hall in London in 1905, the Bible Society was celebrating its centennial. Congratulatory messages were read from rulers of many lands, including Great Britain and the United States. Then the moderator of the meeting said, Now that we have read these addresses from earthly rulers, let us turn our mind to the King of Kings. We will sing, Crown Him with Many Crowns.
Thank you for singing so well tonight. I always say that the people at Hope know how to sing. I think we have great acoustics here when we have people that just about fill the pews and hear everyone singing. It's a tribute to all of you that you're able to do that. It makes me get motivated up here more yet when you sing so well. So thank you. Sing at home as well if you're not doing that now. And aren't they beautiful stories? If you'd like to hear have an evening like this again, and possibly Mike again and Pastor again, you know, we get kind of short on time, but they were, and Pastor, when you had the lead up to this Wednesday group here, it's just wonderful. So we want to thank you for coming out on these Wednesdays.
Thank you.